η επίσημη συνεδρία υποδοχής του κ. Αριστίδη Κρυλή ως αντιπιστεύοντος μέλος της Ακαδημίας Αθηνών. Πάνω στο λιώτατε η Αρχιμανδρίτη Πατέρα Νικόλαε, εκπρόσωπε του μακριωτάτου Αρχιεπισκόπου Αθηνών και Πάης Ελλάδος κ. Ιερώνυμου. Αξιότιμες και αξιότιμοι συνάδελφοι ακαδημαϊκοί, εκλεκτοί, προσκεκλημένοι και λυποί παριστάμενοι. Η Ακαδημία Αθηνών υποδέχεται σήμερα με ιδιαίτερη τιμή και χαρά τον καθηγητή Αριστίδη Κρυλή, διαπρεπή επιστήμονα εξ Ελλήνων του εξωτερικού, ως νέο αντεπιστέλλον μέλος της στην πρώτη τάξη των θετικών επιστημών στην επιστήμη της ιατρικής. Ο καθηγητής Αριστίδης Κρυλής διευθύνει σήμερα το τμήμα της Ανοσιολογίας Λοιμωδών Νοσημάτων και Σεξουαλικής Υγείας του Πανεπιστημιακού Νοσοκομείου St. George στο Σίδνεϊ της Νέας Νότιας Ουαλίας της Αυστραλίας. Η πρωτοπόρος επιστημονική συνεισφορά του αφορά τη μελέτη των ασθενών με σύνδρομο αντιφοσφολιπιδίων, καθώς και τη βιολογία και τους παθογεννητικούς μηχανισμούς των συτευτικών κυττάρων. Στο τμήμα που διευθύνει έχουν εκπαιδευτεί δεκάδες ιατρών και βιολόγων, πολλοί από τους οποίους διαπρέπουν ως δάσκαλοι και ερευνητές σε πανεπιστημιακά και ερευνητικά ιδρύματα σε διάφορες χώρες της Συμφυλίου. Η επιστημονική παρουσία του στη χώρα μας είναι μακροχρόνια και συνεχής. Σημειώνουμε τη στενή συνεργασία του με Έλληνες ιατρούς που μελετούν κλινικά και παθογενετικά το αντιφοσφολιπιδικό σύνδρομο. Για την παιδευτική και επιστημονική του προσφορά έχει τιμηθεί από σημαντικούς διεθνείς επιστημονικούς φορείς. Κύριε Κρυλή, είναι τιμή μας να σας έχουμε ως αντεπιστέλλον μέλος στην τάξη των θετικών επιστημών της Ακαδημίας. Παρακαλώ τον ακαδημαϊκό κύριο Χαράλαμπο Μουτσόπουλο να προσέλθει στο βήμα και να παρουσιάσει την ακαδημαϊκή πορεία και τα επιστημονικά επιτεύγματα του σημερινού τιμωμένου μας.
Καλησπέρα σας, εξοχότατο Προεδρείο της Ακαδημίας. Αισθάνομαι εξαιρετική χαρά και τιμή έχοντας την ευκαιρία να παρουσιάσω την ακαδημαϊκή πορεία και τα πρωτοπόρα ερευνητικά επιτεύγματα του συναδέλφου Αριστίδη Κρυλή ή αλλιώς Steve Κρυλή. Ο συνάδελφος κύριος Κρυλής γεννήθηκε στην Ελλάδα. Πολύ μικρός, 8 χρονών, μαζί με τους γονείς, μετανάστευσε στην Αυστραλία. Τελείωσε το δημοτικό και το γυμνάσιο στο Σίδνεϊ και όντας αριστούχος εισήλθε άμεσα στην ιατρική σχολή του St. George με υποτροφία. Ένας από τους ολίγους συμμαθητάς του. Απεφύτησε στην ιατρική σχολή με επένους, cum laude, και συνέχισε την εκπαίδευση στην παθολογία και αλλεργιολογία στο ίδιο Πανεπιστημιακό Νοσοκομείο. Παράλληλα, εκπώνησε τη διδακτορική του διατριβή, η οποία αφορούσε τη μελέτη των αλλεργιογόνων του κοινού ακάρεως της σκόνης. Στη συνέχεια έγινε δεκτός με υποτροφία στο Χάρβαρντ και ειδικότερα στο νοσοκομείο Brigham and Women υπό την εποπτεία του αημνήστου εξαιρετικού επιστήμονα Frank Austin. Στη συνέχεια, επειδή η απόδοσή του στο Πανεπιστήμιο ήταν εξαιρετική, τον κρατήσαν για τα επόμενα πολλά χρόνια ως επισκέπτη καθηγητή. Ο κύριος Κρυλής, μπορώ να πω ότι αποτελεί παράδειγμα ιατρού ερευνητή. Ένα είδος ιατρών που καθημερινώς εκλείπει. Το 1992 ίδρυσε το τμήμα το οποίο σας είπε ο πρόεδρος της Ακαδημίας, της ανοσολογίας, αλλεργίας, λιμωδών, νοσημάτων και σεξουαλικής υγείας στο St. George, το οποίο έκτοτε διευθύνει. Τώρα, οι μελέτες του αφορούν πρώτον την αυτοάνωση θρόμβωση ή αντιφοσφολιπηδικό σύνδρομο, τη βιολογία των συτευτικών κυττάρων, το οξυδωτικό στρες και την εκφύλιση της οχράς κυλίδος. Τα ευρήματά του στην παθοβιολογία των συντευτικών κυττάρων, στις παθήσεις, μαστοκυτάρωση, αλλεργικό άσθμα και ρευματοειδή αρθρίτιδα είναι σημαντικά και αφορούν τους σημαντικούς ρόλους των προτεασών της σερίνης. Η πιο όμως σημαντική ερευνητική συνεισφορά του καθηγητή Κρυλή είναι η κατανόηση της παθογένειας του αντιφοσφολιπηδικού συνδρόμου. Το σύνδρομο αυτό είναι μια επίκτητη διαταραχή της ενδαγκιακής πήξης, δηλαδή πίζει το αίμα μέσα στα αγγεία μας. Οι γυναίκες που έχουν το σύνδρομο αυτό κάνουν υποτροπιάζουσες αποβολές, οι δε άντρες και γυναίκες με το σύνδρομο παρουσιάζουν θρομβώσεις φλεβών και αρτηριών. Μέσω του πρωτοπόρου ερευνητικού του προγράμματος ανέτρεψε το δόγμα που επικρατούσε μέχρι τότε ότι τα αυτοαντισώματα, δηλαδή αντισώματα που στρέχονται κατά του εαυτού μας, αναγνωρίζουν φωσφολιπίδια. Ο Κρυλής μέσω των μελετών του ανέδειξε ότι αναγνωρίζουν τη γλυκοπρωτεΐνη β2-γιώτα. Επί τη βάση των ευρημάτων αυτών, ανέπτυξε νέες διαγνωστικές μεθόδους για τη διάγνωση του συνδρόμου, το οποίο κανονικά δεν πρέπει να λέγεται αντιφοσφολιπηδικό σύνδρομο, αλλά πρέπει να λέγεται αυτοάνωση θρομποφιλία, και πρότεινε ανάπτυξη νέων θεραπείων που στηρίζονται στην μετατροπή αυτού του μορίου, αυτού του αυτοαντιγόνου του οργανισμού. Έχει δημοσιεύσει πάνω από 270 εργασίες στα καλύτερα περιοδικά. Έχει ένα δίκτυο απήχηση 68 και έχει προσκληθεί από τα καλύτερα περιοδικά όπως το Advances of Immunology, το Blood και το New England για να γράψει προσκεκλημένα reviews για το σύνδρομο αυτό. Έχει επιβλέψει 20 μεταπτυχιακούς και διδακτορικούς φοιτητές. Και όπως είπε και ο Πρόεδρος, πολλοί από αυτούς κατέχουν θέσεις πανεπιστημιακές στην Οξφόρδη και στο Χάρβαρντ, καθώς και στην βιομηχανία. Έχει λάβει από ανταγωνιστικά προγράμματα κατά τα χρόνια της υπηρεσίας του 32 εκατομμύρια δολάρια. Από τα Εθνικά Ινστιτούτα Υγείας της Αμερικής και από το Medical Research του Ηνωμένου Βασιλείου. Τώρα, για την αναγνώριση των μελετών του και των επιτευγμάτων του, ορίστηκε το 2004 πρόεδρος του 11ου Διεθνού Συνεδρίου Αντιφοσφολιπηδικών Αντισωμάτων. Στο συνέδριο αυτό θεσπίστηκαν τεκμηριωμένα κριτήρια ταξινόμησης του συνδρόμου. Έχει επίσης διατελέσει μέλος ή πρόεδρος διαφόρων διεθνών ομάδων εργασίας που ανέπτυξαν κατευθυντήριες οδηγίες για τη θεραπεία και τη διάγνωση του θρομβωτικού συνδρόμου. Έχει προσκληθεί ως κεντρικός ομιλητής, plenary lecturer, σε διεθνείς συναντήσεις το 2014 στην 56η ετήσια συνάντηση της Αμερικανικής Εταιρείας Αιματολογίας στο Σαν Φραντζίσκο, τον είπα, το 2016 πρόεδρος του Συνέδριου Επιστημονικής Έρευνας της Ομοσπονδίας Αμερικανικών Εταιρεών Πειραματικής Βιολογίας και μέλος σε πολυάριθμα διεθνή συμβούλια όπως της Επιτροπής Διεθνούς Ενώσεις Ανοσολογικών Εταιρεών, της Συμβουλευτικής Επιτροπής Ινστιτούτου Βιομεμβρανών του Πανεπιστημίου της Ουτρέχτης, προσκεκλημένος του Πρωθυπουργού της Σιγκαπούρης να συμμετάσχει στο Εθνικό Ινστιτούτο Υγείας της χώρας αυτής, έλαβε αριστείο στην ρευματολογία, είναι μέλος της συντακτικής επιτροπής του καλύτερου περιοδικού της ρευματολογίας Arthritis and Rheumatology, είναι μέλος της εκτελεστικής επιτροπής για την εκπροσώπηση της περιοχής Ασίας Ειρηνικού, εκ μέρους του Διεθνούς Δικτύου για την Οργάνωση Κλινικών Δοκιμασιών του Συνδρόμου αυτού. Επίσης, για τη σημαντική του πρόσφορα, έχει τιμηθεί από πολλά πανεπιστήμια. Το 2003 από την Αμερικανική Ακαδημία Αλλεργιολογίας και Νοσολογίας. Το 2004 ως Distinguished Alumni in Science and Engineering από το Πανεπιστήμιο της Νέας Ουαλίας. Το 2004 επίσης ως Senior Fellow της Ιατρικής Σχολής του Χάρβαρντ. Το 2011 από την Ακαδημία Επιστημών του Ισραήλ. Το 2011 πάλι επίδημος διδάκτορος της Ιατρικής Σχολής του Πανεπιστημίου Αθηνών. Το 2012 εταίρος του Harvard Club of Australia. Το 2014 του απενεμήθη ο Χρυσός Σταυρός του Αγίου Ανδρέα από την Ορθόδοξη Αρχιεπισκοπή Αυστραλίας. Το 2015 του απενεμήθη διάκριση Distinguished Scientist από την Ακαδημία Επιστημών της Αυστραλίας. Το 2016 το διάσημο το μετάλλιο του τάγματος φλεμμολογίας του αντιστοίχου κολεγίου και τέλος ο Πρωθυπουργός της Αυστραλίας του απένιμη το παράσημο Order of Australia. Ο κύριος Κρυλής, παρόλο ότι είναι ένας πολύ άσχολος ερευνητής και κλινικός γιατρός, δεν ξεχνάει ποτέ την Ελλάδα. Είναι παρόν και είναι συνεργάτης μας για τα τελευταία 30 χρόνια. Ειδικότερα συνεργάζεται στενότερα με συνεργάτες δικούς μου, οι οποίοι τώρα είναι καθηγητές, όπως τον Παναγιώτη Βλαχολιανόπουλο, τη Μαρία Τεκτονίδου και τον Αλέκο Δρόσο από την Ιατρική Σχολή Ιωαννίνων. Για όλους τους παραπάνω λόγους, αισθανόμαστε χαρά και τιμή έχοντας τον καθηγητή Κρυλή ως αντιπιστεύουμε εδώ στις Ακαδημίες Αθηνών. Ευχαριστώ.
Ευχαριστούμε τον ακαδημαϊκό κύριο Μουτσόπουλο για την διαφωτιστική παρουσίαση της προσωπικότητας και του έργου του νέου συναδέλφου. Αγαπητέ κύριε Κρυλή, σας καλώ τώρα για να σας επιδώσω το δίπλωμα του αντιπιστεύοντος μέλους της Ακαδημίας Αθηνών. Παρακαλώ τώρα τον αγαπητό νέο συνάδελφο να προσέλθει στο βήμα και να εκφωνήσει την ομιλία του με θέμα «Creativity in Research, Inspiration or Perspiration».
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ, κύριε Μουτσόπουλο, για τα καλά λόγια. Η Ελλάδα για μένα είναι η χώρα μου. Μένω στην Αυστραλία για 69 χρόνια, όμως είμαι Έλληνας ακόμα. Αξιότιμε πρόεδρο της Εθνικής Ακαδημίας της Ελλάδος, κυρίες και κύριοι ακαδημαϊκοί, αγαπητοί συνάδελφοι, κυρίες και κύριοι, αισθάνομαι ιδιαίτερη χαρά... Συγγνώμη, βλέπεις έχουμε και τον κύριο Μουτσόπουλο εδώ να με βοηθάει. αισθάνομαι ιδιαίτερη χαρά και τιμή ανερχόμενος στο βήμα της Ακαδημίας της χώρας μου για να εκφωνήσω την ισόρια ομιλία μου. Πρωτίστως όμως θα ήθελα να ευχαριστήσω τις κύριες και τους κύριους ακαδημαϊκούς που μου απένιμαν τον τίτλο του αντιπιστέλλοντος μέλος της Εθνικής Ελληνικής Ακαδημίας, καθώς και τους ακαδημαϊκούς, ο φίλος μου Χαράλαμπος Μουτσόπουλο και Ανδρέα Τζάκη, που εισηγήθηκαν τη συμπερίληψή μου στο ανώτατο πνευματικό ίδρυμα της πατρόας χώρας μου. Επιτρέψετε μου να επεκτείνω τις ευχαριστίες μου στους γονείς μου. Και αυτό το λέω συγκινήμαι τώρα, γιατί θυμάμαι το καράβι που πήγαινε για την Αυστραλία 45 μέρες και δίχως μεγάλα προβλήματα τότε. Αντώνης και Σταμάτα, που μου δίδαξαν τα ωφέλη της αφοσίωσης στο καθηκόν και τη σκληρή δουλειά και για την υποστήριξή τους ηθική και υλική σε όλα τα στάδια της εκπαίδευσης μου. Ο αυτός τιμή και ευχαριστίες αποδίδω στους μέντορας μου, οι καθηγητές Μπάστεν, Όστεν και Στίβενς, που μου έδωσαν μέσα από την γνώση και την ικανότητά τους για τη μεταδόση της ερεθίσματα για να οριμάσω επιστημονικά και να λειτουργώ ως ιατρός, δάσκαλος και μελετή της ανθρωπινής παθολογίας. Συγγνώμη όμως, τα ελληνικά μου δεν είναι τόσο καλά να δώσω την ομιλία μου στα ελληνικά. Και τώρα θα μεταβώ στα αγγλικά να παρουσιάσω την ομιλία μου. For my family and friends who don't speak Greek, I'm going to give the talk in English. Today's talk is on creativity in research, inspiration or perspiration. Now, the first slide, if one wants to be successful in research, there are basically four requirements for a successful career in science. And these are listed on the slide. As you can see, creativity is one of the four skills required. Many people in science succeed with the first three. For example, those scientists that are meticulous and skilled can make a considerable name for themselves by doing the critical experiments that somebody else's ideas suggest, or by measuring something more accurately than anyone else, etc. However, in the areas of science, such as medicine, biology, and many others, creativity is needed because the phenomena are complex and multivariate. We all know innovative scientists, and they are held in high regard. Unfortunately, the courses of the scientific methods, which few of us take in any event, do not mention creativity. Even the great Karl Popper, in his book, evokes the generation of alternate hypotheses, but says nothing about where one is to get them from. Now, if you look at the literature, there are a number of definitions of creativity, but I particularly like the one from Rollo May's book, The Courage to Create, because it captures the essence of creativity. That is, the process of bringing something new into being, the passion, the commitment, the heightened consciousness, the ecstasy. When the eureka moment finally hits, it might feel like a sudden flash of insight striking, but that's not really true. Even the idea might seem sudden. It's a result of relentless hard work and previously accumulated knowledge and observations. The ancient Greek poet Hesiod captured the essence of the eureka moment when he stated, "Before the gates of excellence, the high gods have put sweat." Now, in more modern times, the prolific inventor Thomas Edison and the philosopher George Bernard Shaw have provided more modern versions of Herod's idea. Believe it or not, the first issue is choosing a problem. And I believe this is a critical and very important step in the research process. As this distinguishes scientists noted by Prosperity, not for their technical skills, but they chose very interesting and solvable problems. On this slide, the horizontal axis denotes increasing difficulty of the problem. The vertical axis denotes the increasing payoff for solving that problem. Now, there are investigators that concentrate down this end of the spectrum where the problems are incredibly hard. The tools are not available to answer those questions, nor the knowledge base. So invariably, individuals that work down this end of the spectrum fail, and the payoff is zero. Individuals that operate down this end of the spectrum, where the problems are easy, they solve it, but the payoff is very low indeed. The critical issue is to operate in the Medawar zone, after the great immunologist and Nobel laureate, Sir Peter Medawar, because in the Medawar zone, there is maximal payoff per unit of difficulty of the problem. In fact, Sir Peter Medawar, shown there, great immunologist, great mind, basically stated science as the art of the soluble, art of the soluble. Now, there are some laboratories where they have a creative spark, the person running the laboratory, who seems to hit that Medawar zone time after time after time. Those laboratories are incredibly creative and productive. However, when that individual passes away or retires, as we have to retire sometime, the productivity and creativity of that laboratory starts to drop. Returning to what is considered normal, because the creative spark is gone. Now, the creative spark is not easily obtainable through the formal textbook portion of scientific training, and it may not arise spontaneously. In fact, the great philosopher Thomas Kuhn basically states in his book, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, intellectually timid scientists produce the bulk of what he calls normal science. Liberating creativity. I constantly say to my students, schools, universities, stifle, inhibit creativity. And they do that by not giving opportunities for exploratory learning, for problem solving. They emphasize single correct answers, and that inhibits the creative process. Barriers to creativity, there are a number. And what I've done, I've chosen from the historical record to an analogy, barriers to navigation, and how in the past, conquering those barriers to navigation and how we can learn from that. And I've chosen the 1400s, and that's a cartoon of Prince Henry of Portugal. He was a great seafarer. And in that cartoon, I've inserted the Innes route of the 1400s. And that was a sailing route from Portugal to Cape Bojador. And when the sailors reached Cape Bojador, they would always turn back. Because? Why? Because they were convinced that this was the end of land and that no ship would ever pass it. However, Prince Henry did 15 expeditions from Portugal to Cape Bojador, The first 14 he turned back. The 15th he went out to sea and passed Cape Bojador. He had the courage to do that. This was a trivial navigation feat. However, the barrier was not a physical one, but a mental one. One so becomes fixed in the mental landscape, immutable. Now what lies beyond that barrier becomes not nearly unknown, but unimaginable. So major enhancements in creativity can be achieved by developing the courage to recognize and overcome the mental barriers, just as Prince Henry did in the 1400s. I say to my students and colleagues, do not let the child inside you wither and die, because the people we know that have been outstandingly creative have been like children. They have a childlike innocence, a sense of wonder. They ask naive questions, and I always encourage my students to ask naive questions because they are the most penetrating, the most interesting. And that's what I believe contributes to the creativity, keeping the mind flexible. To emphasize this point, I want to go to the historical record again to provide some evidence for this. An unusual example. Now, in the 60s, for those that were old enough to remember, there was a space race between the USA and NASA USSR. And NASA in the USA advertised for rocket engineers, rocket scientists, and they got many, many applications. Top universities, top students. But NASA wanted individuals that were creative thinkers. So they asked Dr. George Land to create, to design a creativity test for NASA. And he did, and the rest is history, because the US won the space race. However, Dr. Land had a few questions of his own. What is the origin of human creativity? Are we born with it? Is it learned? So what he did was fascinating. He gave the NASA creativity test to 1,600 five-year-olds. And he was astounded by the results. And I'll share you those with you. You can see these are the five-year-olds, 1,600 of them. They scored incredibly high on the creativity test. So then what he did, he took those five-year-olds and tested them again 5 years later when they were 10, 10 years later when they were 15. And you can see the results have dropped significantly. Furthermore, he took 2,800 ordinary Americans, not rocket engineers or scientists, and gave the same test. They did abysmally, 2% compared to the 98% for the five-year-olds. And as the great painter Pablo Picasso used to say, every child is an artist. The problem is staying an artist when you grow up. I said earlier, schools, universities inhibit creativity because students come into the school and the inner inventor, composer, scientist gets muzzled as soon as they enter this highly structured environment, no thinking outside the box. Year after year, we cram all this information. And it happens in Australia, Korea, the Panhellenes in Greece. Enormous information. After the exams are done, they forget most of it. And we just ask them to regurgitate the information at standardized testing. That suffocates the creative spark. Now, a simple test for creativity involves giving test subjects an object and a goal to see if they can use an ordinary object in unusual ways. For example, a rock and a hammer. Non-creative individuals are stumped by these tests. In science, objects become fixed in meaning. In many cases, as I've written there, an assumption comes to have the rock hardness and permanence of fact. The unknown or ambiguity makes people very nervous. A major obstacle in science is not ignorance, but knowledge. Let me explain that. Here we have the great Greek philosopher Aristoteles. He was so brilliant, comprehensive, logical, and his writings became the ultimate standard of truth. And in our field in medicine and anatomy, Galen's work here provided a similar barrier. You can see here Galen's assumption, hypothesis. He hadn't done the experiment. Oops. There we go. He's got the blood vessels going from the heart to the other part of the body, but nothing coming in, coming back. His assumption was incorrect. However, this impeded advances in the field, even when main manuals of Chinese medicine, years before Galen, stated that all the blood in the body is pumped by the heart, completes a circle, and never stops moving. The other thing I say to my students and colleagues, do not become an expert. Because once you do, you put blinkers on, your ideas solidify, making it extremely difficult to entertain radical alternate ideas or to recognize new problems. One would say the expert is in danger of developing the small cage habit. What do I mean by that? In zoos, it's well known, if you take an elephant from a small cage where the elephant's been in there for many years, take that elephant, put it in a very large cage, that elephant will only utilize the surface area equivalent to that previous small cage. So the danger of becoming an expert is you build your own cage in your mind. And dogmatic people expect everybody else to live within that area, that small cage. Avoid becoming an expert. Now, how does one avoid becoming an expert? The great astrophysicist Chandrasekhar changed to completely new topics every 7 years. He did that even in his 70s. And doing that, he was able to be creative, to avoid a drop in his creativity. Now, I've done a similar philosophy, and I just will take you through this timeline. As Professor Mutopoulos mentioned, I did my PhD on the common house dust mite, Dermatophagoides terenicinus, from the Greek, Dermatophagoide, skin eating, with a Professor Baston at Sydney University. He was one of the first in Sydney to establish monoclonal antibody technology, which was state-of-the-art then. Obviously, it's not state-of-the-art now. And I was the first to identify the major allergen of the house dust mite. And as I say to my many PhD students, when you are choosing a postdoctoral studies, choose something completely different to your PhD. Very important. So I took my own advice and I went to Harvard Medical School, as Professor Mutopoulos mentioned in the introduction, and I worked with the great Frank Austin, K. Frank Austin. And I worked on arachidonic acid metabolites, prostaglandins, leukotrienes, leukotriene receptors. And using the technology at that time that was, you know, best practice, I identified, I was the first to identify the leukotriene receptor. And that has led to pharmaceutical companies making leukotriene receptors, and one is in current use, a drug called Montelukast for certain allergic diseases. Now, Professor Austin, amazing guy, he used to come to the laboratory before any of his researchers, even in his 70s, 80s, and early 90s. He retired at 94. His mother lived to 100, and she used to say to him, "Frank, haven't you got the Nobel Prize yet?" He just missed out on the Nobel. He got the Lasker Prize. Then I did 5 sabbaticals. The first 4 at the Harvard Medical School, the 5th at the University of Kyoto, Japan, when the Japanese Society of Immunology gave me a prize to go there. And I chose different topics each time so I could learn biology, different aspects of different biology and different technologies. I worked with Professor Stevens on mast cell biology, mouse, human, how to grow them, etc., etc. I learned the technology of homologous recombination, which at that time it's a molecular technique that can take out a specific gene from the mouse so that mouse doesn't produce a specific protein. Then you would stress the mouse and then compare it to a normal mouse to see what the function of that gene and protein are. I brought that technology back to my laboratory in Sydney. I worked on age-related macular degeneration. And I have an expert in the audience, my son, who's an ophthalmologist. So he'll pick me up if I say anything wrong. The macula is involved in central vision. And in this condition, it's damaged. So you lose your central vision, but you keep the peripheral vision, which is due to other cells. As you can see on the right, it's normal vision. Now that becomes relevant later in my talk. I worked on ischemia reperfusion injury in mice. That is inducing a heart attack in a mouse and using different techniques, technologies, to learn what goes on and learn from it so we can translate it to the human. And I worked on antiphospholipid syndrome, which I'll also talk about later. Don't read the literature. For the scientists in the audience, they're probably horrified. Now, I know many PhD supervisors, the first thing they tell their PhD student, they choose the topic, then they give them a whole list of references, and they say, go away and read this in detail. No. That's not what I do. It may be okay when you're a young student, but when you're doing a PhD or you're a practicing scientist, I think there's an element of destruction. Because unfortunately, a lot of the literature has just gone down well-worn pathways. And you may have a gem of an idea, but when you look at all the studies, a lot done by eminent scientists in the field, they may actually say in those publications, your idea is wrong, without testing it. They haven't done the experiment, like Galen with the circulation. And you may abandon your idea. Unfortunately, a lot of the literature is incorrect. The great Sir Peter Medawar that I mentioned earlier in fact advised against reading too much, arguing that study cannot be a substitute for research. What I advise my PhD students is the following. When they get a good idea, to think about the idea, do some quick laboratory experiments to test that idea. Only after the idea has incubated, germinated, developed, and you have done the laboratory experiments to test that idea, will it be robust enough to compare it to the current literature?
Obviously, you need a certain amount of knowledge. You don't want to reinvent the wheel, but you don't want to kill that idea either. The other frightening thing is, there's a lot of literature that is potentially fake. And I'm afraid to say, with time, it's getting worse. Here's a study where from 2010 to 2020, this line, vertical line, is the number of publications per year. On this side, it's the percentage of potential fakes. And the red line denotes the potential fakes. And as you can see, the line's going up. 30% of publications in neurosciences is potentially fake. 20% in medicine. So that's another reason to be very wary of the literature. What can you do to be creative? Now, we expect scientists to come in 8 hours a day. Some laboratories, when I used to work at Harvard, the guys wanting to doing their PhDs, they'd work 14, 16 hours a day. However, to be truly creative, you need time to think. For example, if an artist came into his or her studio, started splashing paint everywhere on the canvas, you wouldn't see anything of beauty. And I'm sure Professor Mitsopoulos knows, because he's a painter and he appreciates good art. So thinking in preparation is critical. The most famous painting in the world, the Mona Lisa, that is in the Louvre in Paris, painted by the great Leonardo da Vinci. And documents in the Louvre state that it took Leonardo da Vinci 12 years to paint the Mona Lisa. Two of those years, it took him to paint the lips because he had time to think. He did dissections on cadavers to see the musculature, how it was around the lips. And there are a lot of scholars that have examined the Mona Lisa. And one of them, Professor, it's off the scale, a professor from Harvard basically discovered that if you look straight at the lips of the Mona Lisa using your macular vision, you don't see the smile. However, if you do it to the side at the lips, you see Mona Lisa's smile. That is because the genius of Leonardo da Vinci was, he actually painted that area. Oh, how come it's going forward? He painted the Mona Lisa's smile in almost entirely low spatial frequencies. And so it's seen not by the macula, but by the peripheral vision that are different cells in the retina. That's because he had time to think. Thinking. An incredible metabolic event. The neurons are firing. They're utilizing a lot of energy. 25% of glucose of the body and 20% of oxygen from the bloodstream when you're thinking. An incredible metabolic event. Because, and considering 2% of the brain is 2% of body mass. Thinking. And as Subramanian says, thinking is the hardest work there is, which is why so few people engage in it. Thinking. Now, a great thinker was this fellow, Sir Charles Darwin. Even in his old age, shown here, he was a great thinker. And he would do that by walking every day. In the morning, in the afternoon. And this is the actual path that he used to walk on. He had this constructed in a loop, away from his house, away from his wife, away from his children, so he would only be able to think of his research. And He constructed this a loop so he wouldn't even have to think how many times he did the loop. At the start of his walk, he would put pebbles. And each time he'd come around, he'd kick one away. So during these moments, he didn't have to remember how many times he did the loop. Thinking. No, and walking. However, in more modern times, running is in vogue. And the great Japanese writer Murakami, in his autobiography, What I Talk About When I Talk About Running, basically states when he's running, his creative juices. That's when he gets all his creativity. Interestingly, this guy runs marathons. That's a young picture of him. He's a old man these days, but I thought I'd show a young photo. And he runs marathons. And the first marathon he ever did was the Athens Marathon, but he ran it backwards. Instead of running Athens to Marathona, he ran Marathona to Athens. Furthermore, he writes in his autobiography, most of what I know about writing, I've learned through running every day. That's an extraordinary statement, because this guy, an extraordinary guy, he used to run a jazz club up to the age of 35 when he sold it and became a full-time runner. Thinking and running. Now, be unrealistic. The other thing I tell my students is to be unrealistic. Believe that your research and your abilities and mental capacity are extraordinary. If you just have a realistic view of your own abilities, you'll never attempt problems that are very interesting, very hard, but solvable. That's the key. And you'll never know. Now, above a certain IQ, which is not very high, there seems to be little relationship to creativity, which is interesting, nor productivity. Now, I mentioned earlier, Galen's view of the circulation was incorrect. It impeded advances in the field because it became rock hard and permanent effect. He hadn't done the experiments. In contrast, the great Dutch anatomist Vesalius did the experiments. He did the dissections himself on cadavers, and he reported what he saw rather than the authority of Galen. And he wrote simple diagrams, simple ideas. In Australia, we have two granting bodies. For medical research, we have National Health and Medical Research Council. For non-medical research, we have the Australian Research Council. And I say to my colleagues and my students, the review process is deeply flawed. It inhibits creativity. For example, they ask you to write a hypothesis, aims, methodology, and anticipated results. We know science doesn't operate like that because you get unexpected results. Nothing to do with the grant that you've spent months writing. So I have a saying in my laboratory. We follow what the results tell us. I had a lovely NHMRC grant, and when we started the experiments, we got totally unexpected results. So I followed that unexpected result. Nothing to do with the grant that I spent months writing. So, as Professor Mitsopoulos has alluded to in his very generous introduction, we discovered something in the antiphospholipid syndrome. The condition, as Professor Mitsopoulos mentioned, involves patients that get clots in the veins of their arteries, which can break off, go to the heart, lung, and cause death or other problems. Clots in the arteries of the heart, causing a heart attack. Clots in the brain, causing stroke, and in women, recurrent miscarriages or intrauterine death. Now, it's thought that the condition is due to antibodies, it was thought, binding phospholipid. Again, as Professor Mutsopoulos said, the antibodies don't bind phospholipid. We discovered that the antibodies bind beta 2 glycoprotein 1. And with that knowledge, we developed an ELISA, a test. We patented that test, which the university sold at very low price to a Japanese company. That's another story. The thing is, don't let universities sell your patents. Get a commercial backer. And the test is used in Sydney, in Athens, etc., all over the world. Furthermore, the discovery that the antibodies bound beta 2 GP1 led to pharmaceutical companies using that information and modifying the protein for use in treatment. And I put on an international congress on antiphospholipid syndrome in Sydney. And as part of that congress, I had a committee, international committee, to look at updating the classification criteria for this condition. And the fact that we discovered that the antibodies bind beta 2 GP1 and not antiphospholipid antibodies has helped the, excuse me, diagnosing and managing these patients. I will briefly mention, this is, if you have a patient that has thrombosis, that's clot in the vein or the artery, or and or recurrent pregnancy loss, that is miscarriage or intrauterine death. Plus, you have to have the laboratory test positive. Previously, there were only two tests, the LAC and ACL. I don't have, I don't have time to just talk about those. We added at that time, updated the criteria, anti-beta 2 GP1 antibodies, and that has helped significantly in identifying these individuals and managing these patients. Now, let's say Charles Darwin was applying for a ARC grant, and this proposal is for the chief investigator, no other investigator, a geologist by training, to solve the problem of speciation. I did say to you that the review process is deeply flawed, inhibits creativity. The reviewer would see that, and I'm sure individuals in the audience will appreciate this, and they say, he has no expertise to solve the problem of speciation. He is a trained, his only expertise is in geology. He's a trained geologist. So they would, the reviewer would say, down. Methodology, collect every possible fact and formulate an all-inclusive theory. The reviewer would see that and say, this is a fishing expedition. Sorry. It's not focused. So mark it down. Duration. 20 years. We only give grants 3 to 5 years. So it would be rejected. So I would like to finish, and I say, and I'd like to thank all the colleagues for admitting me to this great institution. I'm humbled and honored to accept the award as corresponding member of the Academy of Athens and to become a colleague of extraordinary academicians, some who I met here tonight from Greece and abroad. Thank you.
Thank you.
Αγαπητές συνάδελφε, σας ευχαριστούμε για την πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα ομιλία σας. Σε γενικό επίπεδο, η όποια δημιουργικότητα στην έρευνα εξαρτάται πρωτίστως από την επιστημονική κατάρτιση και το βαθμό νοημοσύνης του κάθε ερευνητή, σε συνδυασμό βέβαια και με το χρόνο που αυτός διαθέτει για αυτήν. Όπως ήδη ακούσαμε, τα παραπάνω ισχύουν και δεν μπορούσε να είναι και κάτι διαφορετικό και για την ιατρική επιστήμη, της οποίας η δημιουργικότητα σημαίνει βέβαια συχνά να έχει άμεση επίπτωση στην ανθρώπινη υγεία και γι' αυτό και ακριβώς αποσπά ένα μεγάλο μέρος του ενδιαφέροντος του κοινού. Οι ιατροί ερευνητές σαν εσάς, κύριε Κρυλή, δικαίως δίνουν στο επάγγελμα του ιατρού διαχρονικά αναλύωτη αξία και αμείωτη σπουδαιότητα. Η Ακαδημία Αθηνών με χαρά σας καλωσορίζει στις τάξεις της και σας εύχεται ολόθερμα επιτυχή συνέχιση του σημαντικού έργου σας. Λύεται η συνεδρίαση.